Do you think that the Rouliad itself can be an observer? I know we're going back to observation, but I'm curious.
Oh boy. Not really. Not an observer like us. See, here's the thing. The one feature of us, and it's another implicit assumption, is we're kind of small and integrated. That is, our minds, you know, by the very idea that we have a single thread of experience, our minds are not too extended. If our minds were sort of vastly extended, we wouldn't have the same sort of sense of coherent identity. So, you know, one picture is about the Rouliad, is we say, let's go explore the Rouliad. Let's go look at sort of, you know, let's go colonize Rouliad space. Let's go explore further and further out. And you say, maybe that's the point of civilization. Maybe that's what we're, you know, maybe that should be our goal. Just like we explore physical space, we explore Rouliad space, etc. Well, the problem is that when you are sort of holding in your mind all of these different possible views of what's going on, in some sense, but by the time you have all those different views all stuffed together in your mind, there's no coherence to what you think. And so in no meaningful sense can you say that you still coherently exist. You are everything, but you're also nothing, so to speak. In other words, the concept of coherent existence, I think, depends on the choice that it is, there are things that are you, and there's lots of stuff that isn't you. If you say you are everything, then in some sense there's no you in that picture, so to speak.
Interesting.
So I think that what is necessary is that in order to have kind of coherent existence, we have to be limited. That's, you know, a way of thinking about this, a much more formal way of thinking about this in mathematics would be, well, you know, you want to prove theorems in mathematics, you know, what you care about is having a limited set of axioms, then building a tower of theorems on top of those axioms. Well, you could say, well, what if you just allowed all possible axioms? You know, then you could prove everything. And why isn't that a good thing in mathematics, so to speak? You can just prove everything. Well, what does that correspond to? In mathematics, it's kind of an old result in logic that as soon as you have something that you consider false, you can deduce anything from false. Implication, the logical rules of implication, given that you start from a false premise, everything becomes true. And at that point, it's like then you've sort of blown up everything. You can no longer make a coherent statement in mathematics. By the time you throw into the things that you believe something which is false, then you can derive everything. Then everything is, in a sense, everything is true. As soon as you take as a premise something which is false, you sort of have to conclude that everything could be derived as true. And at that point, you can no longer sort of build a coherent mathematics. And so I think it's the same kind of thing that by the time sort of you as an observer span the Rouliad, you do not in any coherent sense exist. And so that's kind of for observers like us, that's kind of a downer.
There are different logical systems, like there's classical logic, and then there's paraconsistent, where you can have A and not A, but not explosion. So in your Rouliad approach, is there something that's like the canonical logical system? So it's, I don't know,
yeah,
intuitionist logic?
That's a good question. I mean, I think that, in a sense, everything we've done is sort of a constructivist approach. The idea of logic with true and false and so on, I've never thought was that great. I mean, there's an awful lot of things in the world that are neither true nor false. You know, it will rain tomorrow. That statement is neither true nor false. It's as stated now.
Yet to be determined.
Yeah, right. But I mean, as a practical matter, you know, you can try and shoehorn everything into, it's got to be true or false. But that's not the reality of most of what we talk about. You know, if I say in Wolfram language, for example, I say X is greater than 3, but I've said nothing about what X is. There's nothing I can do with that statement. It's just, well, it's the statement X is greater than 3. Maybe there's some other statement I can derive from that, but that statement does not have a truth value. That statement does not, in any useful form, have a truth value. It's just x is greater than 3. We don't know. And I think that the things we're doing in Physics Project and the metamathematics that comes from that and so on, it's all constructive. We're saying you can build a thing this and that way. We're not asking the question, we're not formulating it as what is true. We're formulating it as what can you build? And so you don't really get into the same, you don't get into the same kind of binds, and you don't have to force yourself into this kind of question of what's the logic, so to speak, because there isn't a logic. It's just what can you build? You know, in other words, if I say, what is true in the world? Well, in mathematics, you could say, what's true? Okay, I don't know whether mathematics can answer that question. Because in mathematics, if you think about it in typical foundations of mathematics, it's like, well, there are these axioms. And given those axioms, you can derive things. And you say, well, is this actually true? Well, if you change the axioms, you might be able to derive it, you might not be able to derive it. What we're concentrating on is purely what can you derive. And I think that's, and that's similar to what can exist in the world, what can be produced by physics in the world. That's a similar kind of question. You don't say, is the earth true? You say more, does the earth exist? Has the earth been produced by physics? And so similarly in mathematics or in other kinds of ways we talk about things, we say, can this be produced? Not, is it, quotes, true?
Earlier when you were talking about, okay, so there's one view that you can go into a field and make progress because you're bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and you don't have the dogma of the whole history of the field indoctrinated upon you. But then there's the other view that, no, what you need to do is familiarize yourself with the tools, gain the intuition. You need to understand where the field is before you can make some progress. So it was my understanding that you were advocating at least for the latter. Do you feel, what is the largest myth, quote unquote, of modern science that is preventing, in your opinion, some major breakthrough? Like, where do you feel we're being held back most? Other than, hey, we should be thinking more computationally. So other than that.
Yeah, right. No, I think, I mean, by the way, your sort of dichotomy between know the field deeply and don't get too dyed in the wool in the dogma of the field, that's an interesting dichotomy. And I think the main way you get out of that is, I suppose, unkindly, you could say, by being arrogant or confident or something. Because...
Explain.
Well, because, I mean, if there's a dogma in a field... And you're not really confident. You say, well, I guess that's probably true. You know, you have to have a certain, look, I know that's the dogma of the field. I understand that dogma. And by the way, I think it's nonsense, right? That's a non-trivial, almost emotional thing to say, right? You have to be very, you know, it's not most people who come along and say, well, most people will come along and say, I'm looking at this field, I don't really know much about it, its dogma must be wrong. That's probably a lose. It's
right.
Most people, by the time they've learnt the dogma, it's like that's what they're living in, and they can't see anything outside of that. And so I think, you know, in my own case, I've been lucky in that I've worked in a lot of different fields, and so I can kind of see a little bit from the outside. Some of, you know, I've learned the dogma of a bunch of fields, but I can kind of see that from the outside. And I've had the experience of seeing these dogmas just turn out to be wrong over and over again. And, you know, I think that that is and I've had the experience, the kind of, you know, personal arrogance experience or something of realizing, yes, I figured it out correctly, even though the dogma said something different and the dogma was wrong. I mean, that was, you know, in my early life, I, you know, was able to figure out a few little things in particle physics where that kind of thing happened, but they were small. But gradually they got bigger because after you see, well, you know, I mean, I remember there was one thing when I was like 17 years old or something where you know, I'd calculated a bunch of things in particle physics, and there was some experiment that said what I, you know, calculated had to be wrong. And I'm like, I'm pretty sure this is how it has to work. Either QCD is wrong, or this is how it has to work. And, you know, and turned out I was right. And I felt kind of stupid for not having checked more about how the experiment was done and so on, because I probably could have realized that, you know, there was some fishiness there, so to speak. But it was, you know, that was a fairly small thing. But after you've done a few of those things, you build up a certain amount of confidence that, hey, you know, just because everybody says X doesn't mean that X is necessarily true. And that's a super useful thing from a personal point of view to realize. And you know, one could say, well, I think something different from what people usually think. And, you know, one may be just completely wrong. One may think that a bunch of times, and one may be wrong every single time. You know, my personal experience, for whatever reason, you know, I happened to, perhaps because I started smaller, I happened to have had the experience of being right a bunch of times. And that really helps one to have the confidence to think differently, so to speak, about the things that are, you know, some accepted dogma. In terms of right now, I don't know, things that people widely think that, I think there are different kinds of issues. There are places where people think that problem is too hard, it will never be solved. And, you know, like, we'll never know how physics fundamentally works or whatever. We'll never know how this or that works. It's hopeless. Just give up. That's one category of mistake. The other, you know, there'll never be a theory of economics that makes any sense. There'll never be a fundamental theory of biology. There'll never be, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's first thing is that's the second thing, I suppose, is often when there has been technical success in a field, things get quite locked down. I mean, you know, the belief in continuous space, for instance, is a thing which has been technically successful. And, you know, it's a good approximation. It works. You can figure out a bunch of things from it. You know, a huge amount of mathematics has been built on the idea of the continuity of space. And that mathematics will still survive perfectly well, even if space is not, in fact, continuous. But it's a, you know, to build that tower based on that is a, you know, that's something, you know, people have ended up assuming. I think there are a whole bunch of other more technical things that people assume about how quantum mechanics works, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They're more technical. They're less kind of big picture. I think the another meta observation, which I wouldn't have said until recent years, is, you know, how important is the observer in deducing how science works? I would have expected that everything I could have said about science would be, you know, clearly objective, so to speak, in no way
observer independent. Yeah,
the observer, and I don't think that anymore. I'll tell you another thing about a fundamental thing, which is how far is science going to get? In other words, what kind of thing can we expect from science? There is this idea that, look, you know, we just write down equations, we crank out the answers, we can predict everything. You know, you give us an epidemiological situation, we can predict for you, you know, how the epidemiology will play out. We can predict for you how this is going to happen, that's going to happen. We can predict all these things. Sometimes they get very political and so on you know, we can predict what's going to happen in the climate or this aspect of society or that thing or whatever. We can, you know, there's this idea that science provides kind of this, science is the kind of the freeway that lets one get to the end, you know, without going through all the detail type thing. Computational irreducibility is the story of that not being the case. But yet, the absolutely uniform belief about sort of this is the kind of scientism type belief about the world is science. You know, science can explain everything. Science can figure out everything. We can predict, we can see what we have to do based on science. I mean, that was a thing that led to, well, all kinds of beliefs in the world. I think that's a thing where one will have to realize No, there's a certain set. If you pick the right slice of computational reducibility, yes, you can figure out what's going to happen. If you can live in that slice, then you can predict what's going to happen. Life is not so interesting if you're purely living in that slice. If you know everything about what's going to happen, it's kind of like, what does the passage of time really do for you? You know, another version of this that's going to come up, I think, very big time, is the sort of the computational irreducibility kind of fulcrum of AI. I mean, in other words, you've got an AI, it's doing computationally irreducible things. That means you can't predict what it will do. That means it might surprise you. That's door number one. Door number two, let's force the AI to only behave in computationally reducible ways. Let's make sure we know what the AI is going to do. In door number two, you don't get to let the AI do the things it can do. You're constraining it. You're forcing it on this track where it can only do certain kinds of things. You're forcing it to be dumb, so to speak. So there's this big choice to be made. Does one sort of go with what the AI does, let it be computationally irreducible, let it surprise us from time to time? Or does one say, no, we don't want that. We want to constrain the AI to only work this way. This is an important, you know, this is a sort of societal decision, I suppose, that, you know, I think will be a pretty important one in the years to come. And I think it will be, you know, it's not totally, you know, disconnected from decisions about, do you try and control the world, or do you just sort of let, you might say in economic terms, you know, market forces or something else, some other dynamics kind of just play out as they play out, so to speak. Do you go for constraint, or do you go for just let the dynamics play out?
And what do you go for with respect to AI?
Well, it's not going to work to just say, let's constrain it completely, because then we don't really have AI.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.